We would like to thank the Naked Man.
All right. Now that's showbiz, folks.
Doesn't get any more exciting than that.
The Naked Man is a genius to show himself. A free man, free of clothes. We salute you, Naked Man.
Top 50 of all time, my choice. This album kicks off pretty strong. After we get past the mission statement, tonight, we get into the angst, where Corrigan goes through all the bricks in his wall. And I talked about how this album is supposed to be Gen X's version of The Wall. In Pink Floyd's The Wall, there is a moment in that album where he's gone through and explained all the things that built to it, and then he builds it. I bring that up specifically because I want to talk about the difference in building the wall in the Pink Floyd context, where you're building a wall of self-destruction, and he just self-destructs for like the entire second disc until the end, and then he puts his own ass on trial and gets out of it, right? I see these two songs as being sister songs. They're intertwined in the context of the narrative of their respective albums. To get us in the mood, let's watch this thing. This is what this is. Here we go. That goes straight into Goodbye Cruel World, finishes off the first disc, he's gone. That's what this is. This is that moment where everything is built up to this, and I'm either done, I'm gonna self-destruct, or I'm gonna live. Why this is different is Corrigan is providing hope with this album. Fuck all of you. You are not gonna destroy me. Destroy the mind, destroy the body. You can't destroy the heart. This defiance, because he was already behind the wall. Jelly Belly's behind the wall. Zero's behind the wall. Butterfly Wings is behind the wall. Here he is breaking out of that. The defiance to keep your soul alive in the face of all of that shit. For a long time, I thought this was simply a breakup song. Because I don't need your love to disconnect. It's broader than that. It's the love of his parents, it's the love of society, and it's also the love of the girl who's at the center, the chorus of Zero. She's the one for me. She's all I really need. Oh yeah.
Yeah.
That glamorous seductress from the right side of the tracks. That's a big part of this song, but it's also that all that other context too. All the breaks. Rolling Stone 1995 interview. So what is this song about? Billy Corgan quote here: the basic thing is fuck everybody. It's that feeling where no one understand who the fuck are my friends. Fuck you, fuck everybody, fuck everything. It's just that thought, pure frustration. And he later wrote in the liner notes for the reissue, in the jostling about for attention in an era where the mosh pit out front often dominated the focus of our evening's music, Heavy songs were a must to both keep and control the crowd in short bursts of regulated energy. I like this. The more we traveled, the heavier we got. And the heavier we got, the bigger the audience grew, until it was a monster tipping over into those once safe places, where chaos wasn't something you just went into the city and did, only later to forget about it in the safety of your room. Like the circus coming to town, we brought with us all the shadow elephants into the room, asking that they dance nice every night for the amusement of all.
Yeah, he was talking about the heavier they got, the bigger the crowds they got.
Yeah.
And then it was like something in there about like, it wasn't just something you went into the city and did and forgot about.
Yes.
Back in your room. I was like, wow, that's a really kind of poignant thought if you start to like dig into it a little bit more. And I don't know, like maybe talk about pent up rage.
Yes.
In mass that there wasn't maybe as much of an outlet for. And that just kind of struck me.
And ode to no one, so said my Walmart version of the CD that I had back in the day. True title is Fuck You.
Never coming back. Never giving in. I'll never be the shack. Disconnect the act. Disconnect the dots. Disconnect the me.
Teased it before we started about like how I connect to the meaning behind the song, but for some reason never connected to this song. I'm like, I can hear the riff. The riff is awesome. I can hear the Smashing Pumpkins is really good at kind of like building up the intensity, and you can feel the build in intensity. Yeah. And then I'm just like, it's just there. Like listening to it, it feels like it's muted and it doesn't get loud enough.
I don't know if it's fair to say it doesn't get loud enough here, because it builds to that intensity at the end. So I'm curious what your thoughts would be by the end of this.
Like, all I can think when I'm hearing this is, wow, this would be so much better live.
That's funny. Like, our first episode, we watched a live clip of this song, and you didn't like it.
Really?
Yes.
I don't know.
Yeah, you didn't like it. Let's keep going.
But you said you had a lot to say, so.
I do.
And then I just came out with the, I don't like the studio version after 2 months earlier saying I didn't like the live version. Which version do you like better?
This one.
Okay.
What I really love about this song, there's no chorus. The formula gets old with me, everybody. The formula gets old. Anyone looking for a catchy chorus that's coming? It's not coming. This song is dynamic and brings an intensity without the usual tricks.
Yeah.
I'm never coming back. I'm never giving in. I'm not going back behind the wall. I'm disconnecting the act. The me and me that I'm disconnecting is the one that was going to self-destruct. And here we go. No, I'm getting out of this shit. Fuck all of you. I'm leaving.
You can't bring me back. You can't bring me back. Cause I get it all back to you.
Jimmy just fucking destroys on this.
the more of these songs we do, the more I think I start to see why you like Jimmy as a drummer so much.
Yeah.
He's not only a really good drummer, but it's adding to the song, right? You know what I mean? Like, but it's not just there and it's good. It's there, it's good, and it's making the song better. The more we listen to these, having talked about it, the more I hear it. So that, especially since I tend to hear the guitars first, you know.
Oh yeah, of course.
Start noticing the drums, it like really stands out in my mind.
Jimmy's the secret sauce on this song, I think. Jimmy is doing great stuff here. He's all over in the mix. He's hitting all the cymbals. Every other heavy band like this is like, no, I'm just going to grind you in with the thunder, right? No, he's all up here. He's up here. Oh, man. It's epic. I love it. Stop aspect of this, it's amazing. I love it. Man, fuck it up, fuck that formula up. Those lines, destroy the mind, destroy the body, but you cannot destroy the heart. I want that on my fucking tombstone. You could beat the shit out of me as a kid, you can try to tell me I'm worthless my whole life. Guess what, I'm gonna carry the light inside anyway. I wouldn't be where I was if my mother didn't feel the same. She carried the light. She believed in love when it wasn't working out for her. And she gave that to me as a child, even in our struggles. How did she do that? She wasn't shown how to love as a kid. Yeah, because you can destroy the mind, you can destroy the body, you can't destroy the heart. I mean, she carried it. That's like one of the most powerful lyrics that the Pumpkins have ever given me.
What I like about the lyrics is the way he sings them. There's like the emphasis on disconnect, you know, like he kind of fades into the background and he popped back out as if to say, just in case you were wondering, I'm still saying, screw you guys.
Yes.
I don't need you.
Yeah.
I like how he fades away to then come back and make sure.
Yeah.
Like if the whole thing were screamed out in front of you, it wouldn't have the same impact. So I love how he does that.
Yeah.
Cause I think that clearly that's kind of the important word in the lyrics. Right. And I love how they come forward and emphasize it like that.
Bumblebee mouth, and I give it all back to you. I give it all back to you, yeah. I give it all back to you and for you. I don't need your love. This golden ain't making me sorry.
doing to me, man. Whoa. Do you hear him? Mm.
Yeah.
Amazing. Fucking amazing.
I'll agree with a lot of what you're saying. I couldn't put my thumb on what it was that's tying it all together. Maybe it's the drums, but you know, I can't bitch about any of the transitions here because they're all working so well.
Damn right. You're damn right.
I think that one of the things that the Smashing Pumpkins do so well is that whole slow it down, speed it back up dynamic.
Yeah.
They're just really fucking good at it, right? Yeah. And what I love about this one is they slow it down, and when they speed it back up, they get there in a hurry without it being jarring in a bad way, you know?
Right.
Like, I mean, we were joking about this before the video started, but like, I'm the one who's always bitching about the transitions. There's a lot of them in this song, and I can't complain about any of them so far.
This is high praise. High praise. Yeah. I'll take it. Here we go. The money shot.
All right.
The peak of the first disc.
Coil my tongue around a bumblebee mouth, and I give it all back to you. I give it all back to you, yeah. I give it all back to you and for you.
Ready to move on to the love story of this album. But then when I listen to this, I'm like, I'm not ready. I want to hear more. God damn. Thoughts, sir.
You know how when the song started, I said it felt like it was almost muted a little?
Yeah.
I think you're right. I think like by the end of the song, that dynamic isn't there anymore. I also love how they end the song. Right, like they build it up. There's a little bit of like riffage to let it play out, but it's not your standard metal. Let me hit a couple of chords and let it fade out type of riff. You know,
can't complain
about the transitions. Love the solo.
I'll take it, man. I'm very happy. Thank you. It's a big deal. It's such a big deal that it's number.
That's what I was about to ask.
Yeah, where's it on the? Shut up, Justin. Where's it on the list? Here we go. It's number 22. Number 22. One of the highest of the heavier rock songs. Not the highest, but one of them.
Yeah.
We got higher ones coming, y'all. Don't worry about it. I gotcha. But this one is really special to me. And with that, it's time for Zero to fall in love with the next song. So hope y'all stick around. I'm Justin. That's James. He liked it, everybody. I'm happy. Bye.